Welcome to IntelliDOX version 5, which is now certified as a 2014 edition complete ambulatory electronic health record. That means that you can use IntelliDOX version 5 to achieve meaningful use in 2015, whether you're just starting out at stage 1 or you've spent at least 2 years at stage 1 and are now ready to move on to stage 2. This video and those that follow it will help you get familiar with the new features in IntelliDOX version 5. These new features are optional if you're in Stage 1 of the Meaningful Use program and are required if you're at Stage 2. In this first video, we'll show you the changes and additions that have been made to the patient summary screen. The second video will demonstrate changes to the IntelliDOX patient portal and new options for securely communicating with patients and other healthcare providers, including receiving and importing patient information using the standard CCDA format. The third video will cover updates to the meds screen, the new encounters or electronic notes feature, and changes to creating clinical summaries for patients who've just been seen in the office. The fourth and final video in this series will demonstrate changes to some of IntelliDOX's reports, including the security audit report, the clinical search and reminders report, and reports specific to meaningful use, and the new clinical decision support feature. We'll start with changes to the patient summary screen. As you probably already know, you can view the patient summary screen by selecting the desired patient from the appointment list or the patient lookup screen, then clicking the patient's name or IntelliDOX account number to the right of the patient button. The patient summary screen is divided into several sections like demographics, vitals, allergies, and so on. You can scroll up and down in the patient summary screen as you would a web page, or you can click one of these buttons near the top left corner to jump right to a section. If you make any changes on the patient summary screen, be sure to click the Save button down at the bottom right corner to save those changes. The sections that have just been added for meaningful use stage 2 are Family History, Referrals Out, Portal Users, Care Goals, and Amendment Requests. We've also made some small changes in other sections. Let's jump back up to the demographics section at the top of the summary screen. The language field supports several new language options. You'll see a few new options for setting the patient's smoking status: heavy tobacco smoker and light tobacco smoker. There's also a new location field. If your practice has multiple physical locations, you can use this field to record which location this patient normally uses. The allergy section has been rearranged just a bit, and severity information is now stored in its own field. You'll see a couple of new icons at the right side of the allergy section: this blue info button and a black and white details button. We'll discuss the info button in just a moment, but the black and white details button shows an audit trail for this item: who entered or changed the data and when, and any ID numbers associated with the item, such as a SNOMED code for the type of reaction the patient has to an allergen, or the National Drug File ID number for an allergen. The medication section hasn't changed much. It still shows a summary of prescriptions and external medications that your practice has recorded on the med screen, but it too now has an info button at the right side of each medication's name. Click the info button to see a list of links to resources about this item. The information that's available will vary depending on the item, but in many cases will include links to patient information as well as resources for healthcare providers. If the patient's preferred language has been set to something other than English in the demographics section, and patient education materials can be found in the patient's language, links to information in both that language and English will be displayed. To view a resource, just click the link to open that page in a new web browser window. To send one or more links to the patient by way of the patient portal, which we'll be discussing in more detail in just a moment and in a later video, check the boxes to the left of the links you want to share, then click the Send Selected Links to the Patient Portal button. Add any notes that you like to the message, then click Send. The Problem section now supports ICD-10 and SNOMED codes in addition to ICD-9, and now has its own info button and details buttons. Now let's talk about the new sections. Use the Family History section to add details about the patient's relatives and any medical conditions they're known to have. When you click the Add link at the right side of this section, IntelliDOX lets you select a relationship type, such as a parent, sibling, child, or other relative. Enter the relative's name. If you picked a gender-specific relationship like father, mother, sister, or son, the appropriate sex will already be filled in for you. But if you picked a gender-neutral relationship like sibling, the sex field will be left blank. Fill in as many of the other fields as you can. When recording family history, dates can be entered in any of three different ways: as a complete date, including a month, day, and year, as just a four-digit year, or as an age between 1 and 120. If you enter the relative's current age, IntelliDOX will estimate their year of birth by subtracting their age from the current year. If the relative is deceased, you can enter the date of their death the same way: as a complete date, as a four-digit year, or as their age at the time of their death, in which case IntelliDOX will add that age to the year of their birth and estimate the year that they died. By default, new family history records have an active status, but if you discover that you've entered some family history on the wrong patient's chart, you can later edit this information and change the status to archived. Now that you've entered the relative's basic demographic information, you can record their medical history. Click the Add History Item button to enter a condition. IntelliDOX will assume that the relative was diagnosed with this condition, but if you're recording a pertinent negative, you can use the drop-down field in the Type column to select Not Diagnosed With. The Description field in the Family History section works just like the Problem section. You can type the name of a condition, an ICD-9 or 10 code, or a SNOMED code, then select the closest match from the list that drops down. If you know the date, year, or age at which the relative first experienced this condition, enter that in the Onset Date/Age field. If no health history is available for a relative, you can click the Medical History Unknown button to record that. The Referrals Out section lets you send information from the patient's chart to another healthcare provider, preferably using the new Secure Direct Messaging feature, but you can use regular email if the other provider doesn't yet have a direct address. To view or update a referring doctor's contact information, click the Contacts button, Referring Physicians, then find that doctor on the list. Direct addresses look like regular email addresses, but usually contain the word direct somewhere in the address. If a referring doctor gives you an address that doesn't include the word direct, it's probably a regular email address. You can send referrals to regular email addresses, like those available from Gmail, Yahoo, AOL, and many other sources, but be sure not to set this address field to direct unless you're sure it really is a direct address. Even though those look like regular email addresses, they're not. And if you set the address type incorrectly here in the contact list, your referral information will not be delivered. Back on the patient summary screen, you start a referral by clicking the Add link at the right side of the Referrals Out section. Enter the date of service and a brief reason for the referral. Type the referring doctor's name and select the matching entry from the list that pops up. If an appointment date has already been set with the referring doctor, enter that in the Schedule Date field, then click Save to save your changes to the patient summary. You'll then see a Create Send TOC or Transition of Care link at the right side of the referral information. When you click that link, IntelliDOX will create a CCDA format file that contains most of the information from the patient summary screen, and will display that on the Print Send screen. If you want, you can add other documents and scanned images from the patient's chart to the referral. When you click Email Selected Items, InteliDOX will bundle up the transition of care document and any other items you selected into a single file that's ready to be sent to the other doctor. Add any desired notes to the message, then click Complete. When you close the Print Send screen, the Patient Summary screen will reappear. If you close and reopen the Patient Summary screen to refresh it, you'll see that the Create Send Transition of Care link has been updated to show that the referral has now been sent. If you need to send it again for some reason, you can click the Resend link. The Portal User section is new and reflects changes in the way that both patients and their authorized representatives are now given access to the patient portal. In the past, patients signed themselves up for the portal by providing their names, dates of birth, and Social Security numbers. But in the interest of greater security and preventing identity theft, the sign-up process now places control of portal accounts in the hands of the practice. To create a new portal account for either the patient or someone they've authorized to view their information, click the Add link at the right side of the Portal Users section. For this example, we've already granted access to the patient himself. So when we add another user, InteliDOX already knows that the information we're about to enter is for someone other than the patient, and will ask for that person's email address, relationship to the patient, and first and last name. If we were creating a portal account for a patient, all we'd need to enter here was the patient's email address if that hadn't already been entered in the Demographics section. The next step is the same for both patients and their representatives. We enter a secret word or phrase that will be used as a temporary password, and we give that information to the person for whom we're creating the portal account. They'll need that word or phrase to finish creating their account in a process we'll show in another video. Click the Finish button, and an email message with a link to the portal will be sent out immediately. Portal users who forget their passwords will now need to contact the practice to get their passwords reset, but that's easy for you to do. Just click the Reset Password link at the right side of the Portal Users section. The email address, relationship, and name previously entered for this portal user will be displayed. And just as when their portal account was created, you'll need to enter some secret word or phrase to share with them when they call or come into the office. For security reasons, we strongly recommend that you make absolutely sure you're dealing with a patient or their authorized representative when resetting a portal password, and use only secure methods, preferably a face-to-face conversation, to give them their secret word. When you click Send Now, a link will be emailed to the portal user, and with that link and the secret word you gave them, they'll be allowed to choose a new password for their portal account. The next new section is Care Goals. Use this section to record goals that you've set with the patient and instructions that you've given them to help with those goals. The Test Results section now has Info Button functionality, but it hasn't changed otherwise. The last big change on the Patient Summary screen is the addition of an Amendment Request section. As you'll see in the upcoming video about the changes to the patient portal, patients can now notify you if they believe that any information on the portal is incorrect. These notifications are known as amendment requests, and we'll show you how to accept or deny these requests in a later video. The Amendment Request section of the Patient Summary screen shows a summary of the requests that have been received from the patient or their authorized representative, when the request was received, whether it was accepted or denied, by whom and when, the message that the patient or representative entered when making the request, and any notes entered by the person who reviewed the request. If you have any questions about these changes to the Patient Summary screen, please email us at support@busynet.com or call us at area code 918-858-4440, voicemail option number 2. To see the next video in this series, which explains changes to the InteliDOX patient portal and new options for securely communicating with patients and other healthcare providers, including receiving and importing patient information using the standard CCDA format, click here.